Good evening, everybody. My name is Paul Leahy. I'm the director of Center for Western Ethiopia and Eurasian Studies here at Stanford, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the 16th installment of the annual Alexander Galin Lecture Series in Russian, East European, and Eurasian Affairs. As many of you know, the Galin Lectures represent a highlight of Greece's activities and programming over the course of the entire year. It's a series, lecture series founded in 1998 in honor of Professor of History and Political Science and a longtime director of Greece and the founding figure of Russian, East European, and Eurasian Studies at Stanford, Professor Alexander Dalin. Professor Dalin presided over Greece between 1985 and 1989, and then again from 1992 to 1994. Over the course of years, since the lecture series had started, we had the pleasure of hosting many notable speakers, among them Tim Colton, Yuri Levada, Archie Brown, Robert Hebel, Pat Butkov, and many others. And this year, we are very happy that for this lecture series, which, let me also mention, is co-sponsored, co-supported by the Freeman Spogli Institute, we have the pleasure of welcoming yet another outstanding guest, outstanding professor, Mikhail Jan Polsky from NYU. But I will turn the floor to a colleague of mine, Branislav Jakovljevic, professor in the Department of Theater and Performance Studies, to introduce Professor Jan Polsky.
Thank you, Pavle. It is my great pleasure and distinct honor to introduce this year's Alexander Dalin Lecture speaker, Mikhail Jan Polsky. Professor Jan Polsky teaches at NYU's Departments of Comparative Literature and Russian and Slavic Studies, which doesn't even begin to indicate his scholarly and intellectual range. Over the years, Professor Jan Polsky has published 12 books and over 300 articles, which were translated into many languages, on subjects as varied as visual anthropology, political theology, philosophy, cinema studies, literature, modernist painting. For a while, he lectured in performance studies as well, and on literary and cultural figures, and he wrote on literary and cultural figures that range from Russian filmmakers Kira Muratova and Alexander Sokurov to Thomas Hobbes, Hannah Arendt, Antonin Artaud, Sergei Eisenstein, Walter Benjamin, and many others. What characterizes Misha's work is not just his breadth and diversity of his interests. It is not what he writes about, but how. And for this, I have only two words: rigor and originality. Introducing Misha in 30 seconds is an impossible task. So, in the spirit of Daniel Harms, about whom Misha also has written, I give up. Please welcome Misha Jampolsky.
Thank you, Branislav, and thank you for inviting me to this lecture. It's a big honor, of course. And today I would like to present you some ideas on dealing with anthropology and art.
Speak in the microphone, please. Thank you.
In general, I think that anthropology should be used more broadly than it is done in literary and art studies. Anthropology was defined in a very famous book by Immanuel Kant, Anthropology from Pragmatic Point of View, as a response to some situation that are impossible to cover from the point of view of a priori speculative thinking. Basically, if you think about Kant and Critique of Pure Reason and all the three critiques, he is making a lot of a priori statement, and he is developing in a very logical way his evaluation of cognition, of ethics, and so on. but he is writing in anthropology that there are special situations that it's impossible to describe in a critical and speculative way. And it is a practical, this is why it's called pragmatic point of view. This is a fundamentally dealing with behavior of human beings, which couldn't be deduced from any of these kind of general models. So this is why this anthropology is also empirical anthropology, and it's one of the first attempt to place human being into a kind of situation. Every situation is defining in a different way human behavior. I think Kantian anthropology was developed in a much more radical way by Heidegger when he was talking about Dasein as the way of inscription of human being into situation. And we know quite well the situation became a very important topic when I'm talking, for instance, about existential philosophy. What is interesting in Kant, he claims that art should become a part of anthropology. We know very well, of course, that in his third critique of judgment, he's talking a lot about aesthetics in a very theoretical and systematic way, but at the same time, he's claiming that there is a different aspect of art, which is reflecting the inscription of human being in a practical situation, which is reflected in, he's talking, for instance, about plays and novels. So I think it is true that anthropology, from this point of view, could be useful for the understanding of art, and the study of art could be useful for the understanding of this kind of anthropological situation. What I am interested in very much is the inscription of time and history into art and how it reflects certain anthropological situation. What is also for me something that is a starting point of my reflection is a very peculiar inscription of human beings in different kind of situations now. If you think what is the main trend in defining human beings in general, you will find that there are two main trends and they are mutually excluding one another. Human beings now are very much defined as technologically defined. They are somehow incorporated into big technological network. For instance, a big network of information, communication, internet, and so on. And they are thought as a part of this big network. So general idea is that for a very long period of time, humans were using technology as tools. Now technology is incorporating humans into its this kind of network as elements. So this is something which is usually called post-humanist vision of human being. There is a lot of writing about cyborg and this kind of strange incorporation into technological networks. But at the same time, what you find today, it's a lot of stuff dealing with the human animality. So humans are at the same time inscribed into technologies, they are technological kind of, I don't know, supplemental technology. At the same time, you are dealing with very much biological definition of human beings. Human beings are no more separated from animality, and I will not, of course, enumerate hundreds of works that are dealing with animality of human being. I don't know, I'm thinking about Derrida, about Agamben, and many, many others. You know very, very well. This is something interesting, but if you think about history, you will find a very similar situation at the beginning of 20th century. 20th century is immediately, of course, stressing the situation of technology, of incorporation of human beings in productivity, in production. There is this kind of constructivist trend, machinism, futurism, or something like that, where human beings are transformed into a kind of machines. At the same time, you are dealing with vitalism and the philosophy of life, which is developing very, very intensely. So we are already at the beginning of the 20th century, you are dealing with this situation, but if you are going deeper, in time, you will find this situation very much in 18th century. For instance, where there is a fight between mechanicism and Newtonian vision of the world, and something that is defined by Australian researcher Glocker as a movement from mechanism to sensibility. Human beings suddenly start to be described as sensible, which is a very much a challenge to the idea of mechanist vision of human beings. So we are dealing always this kind of couple of mutually exclusive to some extent, but very much parallel vision of human beings. And I would like to think about it as a kind of almost necessary coupling of this kind of technological or mechanistic vision and vitalist visions. They are all always coming together, and I think that there is a possibility to theorize about this couple. For instance, on the basis of Gilbert Simondon philosophy. So Simondon, of course, was quoted several times by Deleuze, but he was very little known, but now he is becoming a great figure, of course, in Western philosophy. And fortunately, two of his books, most important, are translated now into English, but they are still not published. So everybody knows probably that Simondon was a philosopher of something that he was calling individuation. So it's a very specific vision of what is history. History for him is fundamentally the inscription of time into some entity that is acquiring certain individuality. We are starting with a very kind of undetermined entity that is gradually acquiring certain individuality, and this is a process of individuation. So of course we know that this process of individuation is very much important for living beings. Living beings, even in a process of evolution, are becoming more and more individuated. Of course, complex organisms are much more individuated than elementary cells, for instance. But what is interesting, of course, in Simondon, that he described the evolution of technology also as a process of individuation. So there is this kind of strange process of individuation that is a part of this evolution. So what is interesting in Simondon is his definition of the emergence of technology. Technology or technique is for him something which is suddenly appearing at the moment of disintegration of kind of primordial undetermined state of culture, that he is coming primordial religion. We are dealing with, for him, with very magical seeing of the world, religious thing of the world, and suddenly elements of this magical attitude toward the world are transformed into a separate field that he is calling technology. So he is describing it as the transformation of magic into manipulative technology. We are dealing with magical operation, and this magical operation at certain moment are separated from magic itself, and they are becoming technological operation. It had nothing to do with magic. So he's describing the evolution of technology in a way very similar to scientific description of some physical processes. For instance, he's talking about the process of crystallization that is happening in liquids. Liquids could suddenly become crystals, but by becoming crystals, he is writing, there is a certain moment when two states of matter are existing in parallel, and he's calling these phases, but they are not phases or stages in terms of continuity and consequences. They are really representing different states, but they are at the same time present in the matter. There is a kind of short moment where there is already crystals, but still there is already a stage of liquids. So he's calling this situation the situation of saturation, where there is, and of course we are talking about this kind of solutions which are saturated. And there is undeterminacy, but potentiality to become something different. And he is describing this process as a process of defacement. There is two moments which are non-coinciding, and there is something which is transformed into a new state. So he is talking about technology as something emerging also in a very similar way, as a process of defacement magic and religion reaching the state of saturation, and at a certain moment something which is emerging as a different vision or different stage or different phase of the development of the same totality. I will not go, of course, into Simondon because it's not my goal here, but I think in general that this kind of defacement of something which is technological in a broad sense, mechanical, technological in a broad sense, and vital, I mean, something which is very much undifferentiated, dealing with certain continuity, is a process that is very much responsible for evolution. And now I will go to some material that I would like to present you. There are two examples that I would like to present you from Soviet culture of the 20s. One is a very famous, of course, and everybody knows about it. It's a formalist idea of form. And another thing that I will present you is something much less known. It's an idea of biological field, so which is emerging at the same time. And both are very much reflected in art. If you think about the attitude of formalist to film, and basically I'm thinking about Shklovsky, his attitude is very much surprising, because Shklovsky is claiming that cinema doesn't provide us with the possibility of seeing things. So fundamentally it's something which is obstructing vision. Of course it's something quite unusual, because we are used to a very different position. So cinema is opening you an absolutely non-anthropomorphic vision, and this is why it allows us to see things that our custom is obstructing us from seeing. So this is basically the main ideas of Osip Brik, who was writing about it, Dziga Vertov, who was talking about mechanical eye as opening new vision of things, or Walter Benjamin and so on. So there are many, of course, thinkers who are thinking about technology, because it is not anthropomorphic, allowing us to see things that our habit is precluding us from seeing. So Shklovsky has a very different position, and he is claiming that film, and he's basing his rejection of vision in film on Bergson, on a very famous chapter in Creation, Creative Evolution, when Bergson is talking about film. So I will give you a quotation from Shklovsky. The cinema is the child of the discontinuous world. Human thought has created for itself a new non-intuitive world in its own image and likeness. From this perspective, the motion picture is a tremendous modern phenomenon in its magnitude, perhaps not third, but first. What makes film discontinuous? As everyone knows, a movie review consists of a series of momentary shots succeeding one another with such speed that the human eye merges them. A series of immobile elements create the illusion of motion. A film does not move. It only appears to move. Pure motion as such will never be reproduced by cinematography. Cinematography can only deal with the motion sign, the semantic motion. It is not just any motion, but motion action that constitutes the sphere of a motion picture. The semantic motion sign triggers our recognition, we complete it, it does not demand our attention. Fundamentally, cinematography is extraneous to art. It grieves me to observe the development of cinematography. I want to believe that its triumph is temporary. This is from the book Literature and Cinematography of 1923, but in his later book, Ich Nastoyeshe, The Present, he will basically repeats the same statement that film is not producing vision, because it's based on the idea of metric regular cut of reality into regular shots, which are all there, and the movement is reconstructed in our mind. So the movement which is reconstructed, it's not something dealing with real vision of what happens in the world, but with our knowledge about vision. So it's a pure abstraction which is injected in cinema. So film is fundamentally for him technological thing, which is outside art, and very much separated from art, there is no this kind of relation to art. So what is interesting, of course, that he is quoting Bergson, but he doesn't know Bergson well, which is a typical situation for Shklovsky, who quotes a lot and knows many things, but not really deeply. Bergson is writing that every perception is based on our memory. We are not perceiving something, there is no pure perception. He's inventing the idea of pure perception, but claims that pure perception is a pure kind of, I don't know, invention that has no reality. It's a pure theoretical construct. So perception is always a mixture of what we see with something that we already know. So it's something that is, as he's writing, with the immediate and present data of our senses, we mingle a thousand details out of our past experience. In most cases, these memories supplant our actual perceptions, of which we then retain only a few hints, thus using them merely as signs that recall to us former images. Fundamentally, for Bergson, as you see, perception is already based on image signs, something that is Shklovsky writing about cinema, that there is no real movement, there is nothing real, it's all science. And of course, it is not actual perception. What is happening in Bergson? There is always this something that we call, after Simondon, this kind of defacement. There is something which is dealing with certain continuity, but this continuity is contaminated by elements which are not dealing with vision, with perception, but which are coming from our recollection, and they are dealing with recognition finally. It's a mixture of two different things. And in Essai Immédiat de la Conscience, Bergson is giving a wonderful example that is allowing us to see how he thinks vision. Vision is never pure continuity, like Shklovsky wants to think about it. But it's always the process of defacement. So he's describing the work of a clock. And he is describing how we are following the work of a clock, this kind of separate movement of pendulum he's talking about. And he is writing that there are two things which are happening here. One is the continuity of our consciousness, which is not cut in different stages and different phases. In external movement of pendulum, which is fundamentally metrical and mechanical. So there is mechanical and vital, if you want, are always coming together. If there is no this mixture of mechanical and vital, so there is no perception. So I will quote from Bergson, now between this succession without externality and this externality without succession, a kind of exchange takes place. So there is this process of kind of mutual exchange. Very similar to what physicists call the phenomenon of endosmosis. And the successive phases of our conscious life, also interpenetrating, correspond individually to an oscillation of the pendulum, which occurs at the same time, and as moreover, these oscillations are sharply distinguished from one another, we get into the habit of setting up the same distinction between the successive moments of our conscious life, the oscillation of the pendulum, break it up, so to speak, into parts external to one another. Hence the mistaken idea of homogeneous inner duration. This is very important. Mistaken idea of homogeneous inner duration, something that Shklovsky will stress, talking about continuous word, poetry is absolutely uncuttable, words and the form, literary form is fundamental, corresponding to Bergsonian idea of Dieu or something like that. There is no such thing, Bergson is claiming that that is pure homogeneous continuity. It's always cut in part. Or there is an exchange. The idea of homogeneous inner duration, similar to space, the moments of which are identical and follow without penetrating one another. This is his quotation. Now, Shklovsky was opposing technological art, cinema, to literature. And this is the weirdest thing, of course, because he was claiming that literature is continuous, And cinema is cut into pieces, and it's mechanically divided. Of course, everybody knows, it's not a big discovery, that literature is made from words. Words are distinct elements, even if they are combined in sentences and so on and so on. So to claim that language is a pure continuity is quite weird. He's writing. In the world of art, the world of continuity, the world of continuous word, a line of verse cannot be broken into stresses. It has no stress points. It has a place where the lines of force fracture. The traditional theory of verse emphasized the violation of continuity by discontinuity. The continuous world is a world of vision. The discontinuous world is a world of recognition. So poetry is dealing with vision, and cinema is precluding vision and obstructing vision completely. So how it happens? Why this kind of weird idea of poetry as vision and cinema as non-vision? The idea is quite simple for Shklovsky. Shklovsky thinks, and this is a very typical also for a little bit simplistic theoretical apparatus that he was using. So there is, as you know, material and form. And material is everything, and form is fundamentally an application of some operation of cuts and redistribution of material by this operation. So he was, of course, you know, he was a very narratological mind. He was always talking about plot and story. And story is a continuity, and plot is cutting continuity in different elements and can change these elements. But film is something which is resisting it because it's already cut from the beginning. So there is no material. To some extent, the material which is given by film, it's already pieces which are technologically cut. So because they are technologically cut, he is writing, there is no plot. You can take every shot, every fragment, and produce a permutation between fragments, and it's all. There is no fundamentally this kind of strange relation between continuity and discontinuity, which is the idea of defacement. There is always this idea of defacement, which is producing some kind of time, some kind of continuity, some kind of meaning. So cinema is unable to do it because it's already cut into pieces, and it's only operation of permutation, basically, of this pre-existing different elements. Now let me move, because I don't want to be very long here, to Tynyanov, who invented the idea of dynamic form that he developed 1 year after Shklovsky's publication of Literature and Cinema, so in 1924, in his book on the problem of verse language. And he's talking about verse. So what is this the dynamic form of Tynyanov? I'm sorry for telling things that probably everybody knows here, but I have a little bit to recapitulate and to repeat. The unity of the work is not closed, symmetrical intactness, but an unfolding dynamic integrity between its element is not the static sign of equality and addition, but a dynamic science of correlation and integration. The form of the literary work must be recognized as a dynamic phenomenon. The dynamism revealed itself firstly in the concept of constructive principle. Constructive principle is fundamental for his idea. Not all factors of a word are equivalent. Dynamic form is not generated by means of combination or merger. They often use concept of correspondence by means of interaction, and consequently by pushing forward of one group of factors to expense on the expense to the other. So fundamentally, it's an idea of defacement, which is the origin of the idea of constructive principle of dynamic form. You have always in Tynyanov reading of one structural layer against another structural layer, and one structural layer is always dealing with shifts and defacement in relation to another structural layer. So he is giving an example of relationship between matter and rhythm in poetry. And he is giving, what is matter? Matter is fundamentally, absolutely metric, regular division of things. Matter is very much similar to what is film in Shklovsky. Film is divided into a certain amount of frames or shots mechanically, and matter is the same mechanical division of something. And a rhythm, of course, is always fluctuating. It's never corresponding to matter, and poetry is read as this kind of shifts between two layers. One layer is a layer of metrical, mechanical division, and another layer is a layer of this kind of instability of changing stresses on different syllables. So there is this kind of instability which are entering into this kind of situation, and it produces this constructive principle, which is a dynamic form. But what is, of course, interesting, this is quite important, I think, and this is the difference between film and poetry, that there is no such thing as matter. In film, of course, we are dealing with something which is completely tangible and visible. Every frame of a film is physically existing. Something, it's a photograph which is separated from another photograph. But matter has no physical existence at all. It's a purely virtual dimension of poem. We have to have in mind certain regularity in order to oppose to it certain rhythm. So there is this opposition of virtual something to something which is existing. And in film, of course, there is this kind of material itself is already cut. This is why film is purely mechanical. Now, what is for me the most interesting in the whole story, that Tayanov is incorporating very, very early in this idea of constructive principle and dynamic form, the idea of history. The idea of history that he's calling evolution. And of course, all formalists, and we know it quite well, they were rejecting the idea of continuous linear history that they were calling tradition. And they are talking about something they are calling evolution. This term evolution is, for me, of great importance in general when we are dealing with the grasping of history, which is becoming so important after the revolution in Russia. So what is the difference between tradition and evolution? Tradition is pure continuity of certain borrowing, of the use of certain form, of their kind of metamorphosis or something like that. Evolution is not dealing with continuity, but it's dealing with non-continuity. And of course, the most famous example of evolution and formalism is parody. Parody is related to a previous phenomenon of art, a previous form. It could be a parody, I don't know, dealing with a tragedy, classical tragedy, but it becomes grotesque or whatever it is, so it's pure transformation. But still it is related with a previous form. And it creates this kind of exactly constructive principle, because the parody is based absolutely on the same principle that matter and rhythm. We have to find, to keep in our mind, the virtual form that is in the past, the form of classical tragedy, for instance, and we are reading the new form with a parody on this, on again the background of this virtual existence of matter or this virtual existence. So history is very much becoming absolutely understood as constructive principle. So evolution, constructive principle, dynamic form, it's all the same, but it allows the incorporation of history into the art. Art is becoming, through this mechanism of defacement, is always dealing with certain inscription, with certain kind of history or historical time or certain kind of temporality. We are always dealing with the past, which is present in a virtual form in relation to what is experienced in the form. And the parallelism of constructive principle and evolution is allowing Tanyanov to rethink the idea of film. You know that Tanyanov suddenly start to think about film as art. is claiming that because film is also evolving, and film is never able to reproduce art in all its wholeness, so history, evolution is already inscribed in film. And you can read film already in terms of parody, in terms of relation to its own past. So this constructive sense, the history is there in art, and this film is abandoning this realm of pure mechanicity. And there is a defacement of two elements which are entering into art, into film, and through this defacement, it becomes art. It becomes art. So mechanical element is disappearing. So for me, it's quite interesting because you see to what extent this kind of Simondonian idea of defacement of mechanical and vital is in the background of certain vision of what art in formalist, and I think it's very important because we are dealing always with an attempt to rethink history, and it's important after revolution because there is many attempt to think how time and history are incorporated in art. Now let me move into much less known area that I find absolutely fascinating for myself, and I am very much in trying to understand what it is. I would like to bring your attention to a group of absolutely extraordinary intellectuals that in the 20s radically rejected the idea of evolution. I mean this whole group of biologists that were very critical about evolution, thinking that evolution is something, and Boris Kuzin, who was one of these biologists and a very close friend to Mandelstam, who was writing that evolution is something which is always used by Soviet state to justify in terms of causality everything which is happening there. It's always the idea of progress which is always behind the idea of evolution. So we should understand time and what is happening historically in terms of evolution. Kuzin in his memoirs, he's writing that he started as evolutionist. At certain moment he started to hate evolution, and he's writing almost everything that fans of evolution discuss is a delirium, irresponsible fantasy at certain moment he's writing. And he moved toward Lamarckism also, that we know was important for Mandelstam. So Mandelstam for me is a key figure, and I think Grisha Freuden is here, and as a great authority in this, I am a little scared to talk about Mandelstam in his presence, but I think he is really a great thinker. His criticism is very often understood as a testimony of his art, something like that, but I think its meaning is much broader and much more important than we are usually thinking about it. Why evolution was... So first of all, who were these people whom I am mentioning? I will enumerate the most important names. It's Alexander Gavrilovich Gurevich, who was also mentioned by Mandelstam. Lev Semyonovich Berg, Alexander Lyubishev, Evgeny Sergeyevich Smirnov. And Lyubishev is, of course, an absolutely fascinating figure that should be rethought, I think, in terms of his role also in his relation to humanities and the idea of history in general. So what was the main problem for these people with evolution? And it's a kind of well-known criticism of Darwin. The idea is that evolution is producing form. And it produces form as a result of selection, which is a completely random. There is a kind of mutation for instance, that is producing suddenly these forms that are dominating in the world. But fundamentally, it was never explaining the phenomena that they were very much interested in the convergence. For instance, why in the same milieu, in the same place, many very different species that are genetically absolutely not connected, it is impossible to genetically explain this evolution, are requiring similar forms. So why, for instance, mammals like a whale acquire a certain form of a fish being in water? So it's impossible to explain by this kind of random mutation or something like that. So for them, there is something that is responsible for evolution, but is absolutely beyond Darwinian causality. So the main struggle was against causality. And in 1922, Lev Berg published his book, which was very important, Nomogenesis. The book that was very important for Jakobson, for instance, and for Trubetskoy, they were referring to this book many times. Because when Jakobson and Trubetskoy started to develop their idea of Eurasian kind of, I don't know, something they were calling linguistic unions, they wanted to show something which was very difficult to show, and they were going against the doxa of such linguists like Schleicher, who was a Darwinian linguist, claiming that fundamentally it's impossible to explain certain proximity of languages which are developed in the same area between languages that genetically have no common origin. So they called it, Jakobson called it, linguistic union. Linguistic union, it's a kind of weird situation of convergence between absolutely non-connected languages. So in to develop it, they were very much influenced by Berg and by the idea of nomogenesis. The idea of nomogenesis was that there is certain kind of common idea with nomos, it's the law, certain kind of not contingent evolution, but kind of the law of evolution. A certain kind of morphological commonality between species of different origin. So he was very close to Gurvich, who was a student of Hans Driesch, a great German biologist, and whose book Vitalism, who translated in 1915 into Russian, Gurvich. So Driesch developed a weird idea that he took a concept from Aristotle and Telechia, and he thought that there is something which is defining the development of different living beings that he is calling entelechia. Entelechia in Aristotle is the same as a soul. The soul is creating certain unity in the development of human body. And at the same time, there is something weird because entelechia is not a space structure. You cannot see intellectual as a soul, you cannot see it in space. It's not something which could be called energy, for instance, it's not an energy. But it's a weird principle organizing the unity of the body, which is, this is why the soul is something organizing certain unity of biological organism or something like that. And Gurvich in 1912 changed this idea of entelechia into the idea of morphological field. Morphological field is an idea that there is certain kind of energetic field that is defining everything which is belonging to this field to develop into determined direction. And there are point-like sources in something that he was calling equipotential surface. And these sources of energy creating certain tension in this field were responsible for the development of organisms. This field is not static, it's always changing. And what is important, they were thinking that every species has its own morphological field. Our friends were calling it an embryological field, also dealing with the development of embryo. So Kuzin, this is a quotation from Mandelstam, who is describing this idea of Gurvich in relation to art. We were discussing the theory of embryonic field proposed by Professor Gurvich. The embryonic leaf of the nasturtium had the form of a halberd of an elongated, bifurcated purse which grows into a little tongue. It also resembles some Paleolithic arrowhead. But the tension in the field of force ranging around the leaf at first transforms it into a segmented figure with five parts. The lines of the cave arrowhead take on the shape of an extended arc. Take any point and join it with a bundle of coordinates, a straight line. Then extend these coordinates intersecting the line at various angles to a section of identical length, then join them together again, and there you have convexity and so on. So there is kind of field, there is a form which is a very much immaterial form that is responsible for the evolution of everything. Cousin was quick to apply the idea of morphological field to history and to historical events. That he was claiming that fundamentally every individual belonging to a certain group of people is behaving according to this kind of social field, which is also developing. And Mandelstam was reflecting this in his work on a certain kind of unanimity of masses. For instance, human wit, there is a famous essay when he's talking, there are certain moments, there is a catastrophe, where there is no more unity in human beings, there is, they are not creating certain unanimity which could be created by a field. Fundamentally, history could be understood as a collapse of field or re-emergence of field. So he started to deal with this when he was working on rhythm under the influence of Dan Kroos Mandelstam, and he was in his essay, Government and Rhythm, he is writing that there is we are in need of rhythmological unity of society. But after it, he is moving toward the idea of certain kind of fields which are no more working or working, and history should be described in terms of a morphological field associated with humanity. What is, of course, extremely interesting when you are dealing with this idea, and recently they published a correspondence, absolutely fascinating correspondence between Lyubishev and Gurvich. When Lyubishev is permanently attacking Gurvich for being too much into physiology, for instance, between physiology is dealing with determination, with physical determination, with causality, because it's a work, physiological work of organism. And what should be done, absolutely, we should create an absolutely detailed morphological description of different features or different elements. And when making this absolutely detailed, extraordinary description of the field, description, morphological description of bodies, we are able to reconstruct the field which is invisible, like in Telehea, we cannot grasp it, but we can grasp it only through description. What is important, this field is absolutely morphological, it's absolutely non-causal. He is writing to Gurvich, you are still very much in causality, you have absolutely to get rid of causality, because there is no such thing in history as causality. A history should be described completely in terms of morphology. So there is something which is quite interesting when you are dealing with this description of field and centers of energy and this changing field. We are dealing with a very similar thing as the saturation and emergence of something in Simondon. We are dealing also with a very different model of defacement. But this model of defacement is very much going against evolution. It should be important, I think, that Mandelstam attended to Bergson lectures in 1908 in Paris when Bergson just published Creative Evolution. And when Mandelstam is describing Bergson in a very extraordinary way, basically making him a philosopher of field. So I'm quoting from Mandelstam. Bergson, whose profound Judaic mind is obsessed with the urgent need for practical monotheism, offers us a theory of the system of phenomena. System of phenomena is very much non-evolutionary vision of things. Bergson does not consider phenomena according to the way they submit to the law of temporal succession. This is important. It's fundamentally against evolution. But rather according to their spatial extension. He is interested exclusively in the internal connection among phenomena. He liberated this connection from time and considered it independently. Phenomena thus connected to one another form, as it were, a kind of fan whose folds can be opened up in time. However, this fan may also be closed up in a way intelligible to the human mind. To compare phenomena united in time to form such a fan emphasizes only their internal connection. Thus, instead of the problem of causality, there is no more causality here, which has for so long dominated the minds of European logicians, Bergson poses the problem of the connection alone, purged of any admixture of metaphysics, and therefore more fruitful for scientific discoveries and hypotheses. A science based on the principle of connection rather than causality saves us from the bad infinity of evolutionary theory, and not to mention its vulgarized corollary, the theory of progress. So this is a rejection of historicism and a very, very different kind of historicism. It's interesting when you read, for instance, Freidenberg diaries, when she is writing, where she is writing that she is reading Berg, Nomogenesis. And how liberating is this reading? So because я нашла обоснование всего своего заветного антидарвинизма, she said, I think I found the basis for my very deep anti-Darwinism. So fundamentally, all these people, in a very different way, of course, Jakobson, Mandelstam, Freidenberg, they are belonging to very different, they are starting to develop kind of another vision of history, which is incorporated in a very different way in terms of form. Form is becoming something very different in formalism and in the kind of morphological description. And just to finish, I would like to mention Vagenov. Vagenov, who was completely obsessed with systematicity and who invented these kind of collectors which are permanently fighting for describing absolutely unclassifiable things through absolutely minute description into a kind of morphological classification, something that Cousin, for instance, or Lubitsch were trying to think. Lubitsch was trying, of course, to mathematize the field. He was saying that it's possible to think about a morphological field that is creating history in terms of mathematical description. And we can find some attempt to create mathematical description of fields, for instance, Nikolai Bernstein around this time and so on. So there is this kind of attempt. We can describe this absolutely invisible thing and to define history in a very different way, to incorporate it into systematicity. I think that Vagenov's almost parody on the work on Jean Lobin, for instance, who is trying to make an absolutely incredible classification of different nails, something like that. So the form absolutely of very little small details, and we can find final description of something that we are lacking to understand history. So art is to some extent assimilating different ideas of history through different idea of form. Through different idea of form. It could be dynamic form in formalist, it could be morphological form in this kind of deeply influenced biologist thinkers in humanity and art or something like that. So every time you are dealing with a redistribution of what is cut, what is transformed into separate elements, in the continuity, like field, for instance, like relationship between rhythm and matter, or something like this. But this couple is always re-emerging in a very different way in different attempts to think about anthropological position of human being and how art is able to reflect it. Thank you.
Let's see if there are any questions.
I just want to thank you for kind of lifting the veil over a very interesting period in Russian intellectual history. I mean, I don't but I'm not quite sure that one can say that they rejected evolution. Okay, I mean, these were Lamarckians or some other, you know. I can maybe speak about Mandelstam, whom I'm familiar with Kuzin's work, I'm familiar with the Lamarckianism, Lysenko was one.
Yeah.
It's the early 20th century, Darwinism is relatively new, Sturm...
It's not so new.
No, it's relatively new. It's Sturm und Drang, okay, of the late 19th century is sort of over, okay? Genetics is beginning to dominate, the field, but in terms of intellectual history, you see a trend. Darwinism essentially overturned the whole belief system of, European civilization, right? We can't even imagine what an earthquake, that was. And reactions to it did not make themselves wait, Reactions to it was, how can we introduce, our spirituality into this new way of thinking. So this is trying to get religion through the back door, essentially, what we have in these people. That's kind of, that is my sense. It is interesting how they are resonate with formalism. Because formalism is also, at that time is interested in the kind of a deep grammar, problem of the deep grammar that maybe have something to do with entelechia, or in art history, period style, trying to understand the formula for the Baroque epoch, and so on. So that I understand, but I don't find the scientific part, and I'm obviously not a scientist, but I don't find the scientific part terribly attractive. It seems to be kind of, they went the wrong way. I mean, they went some. Mandelstam, speaking of Mandelstam, on the one hand, you could see him very attractive to Lamarckianism, but you can also read his essay on Darwin. I mean, he's as sweet about Darwin as about anything else. What he writes about Bergson, I don't really think he really understood Bergson. I never found any fans in Bergson.
Fan in Bergson is in Creative Revolution. I can just give you quotations
from
Bergson,
which
is completely corresponding to his Mandelstam.
Because I never did. I mean, to me, it's also, it's a strange sentence that you quoted it. I've always wondered about it, whether it was Bergson was more important, the fan, Judaic mind, monotheism. It's again, there's a connection with religion. That to me is very important. That, Bergson too, his critique of rationalism and, critique of Darwinism, had to do with the religious sensibility that simply did not want to go away. And of course, at that time, there were certain facts that evolutionary biology could not explain, like the similarity, the identity, or the equivalence of forms, the eye of a seahorse. I mean, Bergson constantly refers to it. In Mandelstam's usage, he understood it as religion, and his poem to Lamarck, which was written on the, I think, on the anniversary of his death or birth or something like that, he verbalizes that understanding very clearly, that if evolution is random, then I would rather be with the beings at the very bottom of evolution. It is the randomness that he cannot stand. And it is the randomness that the people like Kuzin could not accept, and Einstein couldn't accept it either, right? God doesn't play dice with the universe. So it was very typical of that generation.
Yes, and I agree with you that they are thinking that it's not random. This is nomogenesis of Burke, is exactly the idea of the research law. And there is something, I don't know, Lamarck, I think, is a complex question. To what extent Lamarck is real Lamarck in what they are doing? I don't think that...
The inheriting acquired characteristics, that's what...
Yeah, no, this I understand. Yeah. No, I mean, what is important for in Lamarck...
These people were being wiped off the face of the earth. The revolution happened. They were old world people. They have no place.
This is quite clear for me, that this rejection of certain kind of determinism and the idea of progress and historical continuity as a pure demagogical thing which is used by the state and things like that, it's of course dealing with certain kind of disappointment of this intellectual... This is clear for me, absolutely, and of course all these collectors in Wagner, they are also bivshi ljudi, whatever it is, but they are trying to do it. Something of this kind. But I think what is important in Lamarck is the possibility to see the evolution as a picture that could be grasped as a certain kind of image in which there is this distribution of force or something like that. So it's fundamentally the transformation.
But it's an Nesnitzer.
Yeah, and it's very different from the idea of tree. It was very early applied to Darwinism, and they started to think about it as in terms of the tree. Of course, Darwinism was very much under the critique because of the idea of the genesis of man as a kind of, that didn't exist in the origin of species, because the origin of species has no unity of evolution. There are different species which are emerging, but they are not converging toward human being, which is the crowning of the process. So it started, of course, with the idea of the evolution of man from monkeys and all this kind of story, when the idea of trees started to become something kind of evolutionary linearity or something like that. But I think they are dealing really with the transformation of genealogical continuity into spatial construct. What they are trying to describe. This is a very different form. I think there is a form in formalists which are dealing more or less with kind of temporal discontinuity and continuity and defacement. And here we are dealing with this big field. This is why I'm using the word field that Gurevich invented, and I think it's very well describing what it is. It's a morphological field that is creating history. So it's no more causal, it's morphological. We can claim that some of them were thinking about it maybe in terms of religion because it allows this kind of globalizing vision. There is a kind of super eye that sees the whole natural history. Yeah. No, it's
design.
Not. I don't think it's an intelligent
design.
Well,
intellectual, that's what.
Yeah, no, intellectual, it's not dealing with any kind of course, design. But yeah, they are moving into different directions. This movement is very much explained by their anxiety about revolution, about what happens. And it gives you them very different tool to think about. So for them, it could have religious background. For some, probably not. You see Smirnov, for instance, who is completely in Goethe. They started to publish Goethe around this time, and the idea of morphology with Goethe, which is emerging very much, so there is romantic element there. Goethe's influence is absolutely capital, and so on. Of course, it's a complex phenomenon. It's very difficult to define it in a simple way. But I think it's many participants of this trend are belonging to, in terms of religion and something like that, belonging to different kind of strata, if you want. But I agree with you, but at the same time, I think it's what I was trying to do here is to describe two models of defacement as historical models which are becoming a kind of artistic form. And it's interesting that Mandelstam, for instance, has a complex relation, of course, with formalism, which is quite obvious, but he is, for instance, describing the emergence of new genres, something that he's calling folklore. Folklore is something that formalists were using in terms of anecdotes, in terms of journalism, whatever it is. And his writings, there is no absolute evolutionary element behind it. It suddenly emerges like the state of saturation from everywhere.
There is
this enormous noise which is produced by all this stuff, and this enormous noise suddenly produces new form. It's something like that. So this is, for me, this is really extraordinarily different vision of what evolution is.
Yes, please.
Thank you for the talk, it was fascinating. I'm curious whether you would connect this idea that you've been discussing of the morphological form to something like, I think of like Van Uskel and his notion of the Umwelt, the idea of like the reciprocity between an environment and an organism within it, and particularly maybe as that might pertain to the idea of the relation between, say, something like form or content, matter or form. Because, you know, again, thinking through someone like Simondon, the question of what he calls hylomorphism and the sort of idea of like a sort of inert, as you're saying, serialized sort of material that this becomes imprinted becomes a pretty crucial question. So would you see something like, say, the morphological field and the idea of Umwelt, if it is in dialogue, yeah, somehow being an antidote to something like hylomorphism, or how do you?
I think it's possible to connect it, because there is probably, they are belonging, I think, UXQ and these people are belonging. Of course, they are very different, because UXQ is not morphologist at all. So he's talking about, of course, about ungraspable configuration of something that he's calling Umwelt, which is permanently changing. When he's talking about different Umwelt for a shark who is hungry or not hungry, it's fundamentally absolutely including or excluding something. The reason behind it is very different. And we know, of course, that UXQ was very much used by, on the one hand, Cassirer, who was completely fascinated, and on the other hand, with Heidegger and so on. But of course, this description of Umwelt, which is proto-phenomenological, is very different of what they are doing. Because how to tell why I think it's different? And at the same time, there is certain similarity, because in both cases, there is some kind of sphere in which something is included and which is defining its behavior and relation. I think that UXQ is really dealing with a kind of animal phenomenology. Animal being is immediately defined by some this kind of living world, which is opening, like in phenomenology, basically to human beings, in which one to animals, which is in which they are inscribed. For morphologists, there is absolutely no idea of subjective phenomenological experience of the world. It's an idea of absolutely objective external description. They are completely obsessed with minute description and mathematization of this description. They are, Lubitsch is the most extraordinary, because he's always trying to find very complex mathematical apparatus to describe a morphological field, which is absolutely non-dependent on any kind of, I don't know, existential inclusion into something like that. So it's a description of form. It's closer to Thomas d'Arcy or something like that, dealing with morphology of development. But it's but at the same time, you are dealing with something that could be described as field. This is why I think there is a certain analogy between them, but fundamentally they are not of the same kind.
Thank you, Misha, very much. So your discussion stops basically with Mandelstam, and as Grisha said, these are Birshi Dudi. It seems from what we've heard here that it's a sort of dead end. So on one hand, I wanted to ask you what happens with this thought in Russia and in Soviet Union, and then on the other hand, there are resemblances, strong resemblances with some other biological models that emerge much later. For example, Henri Atlan's writing on noise in the early 70s. So I wanted to just see if there are, you know, his idea of noise to me is very reminiscent of the idea of morphological field. So it is a certain saturation of non-causal processes that somehow produce something in a certain
way. Atlan is such a complex case, as you know, that it's, for me it's very difficult to talk about him, because it's a weird, strange mixture, I think, of certain morphological ideas, I agree with you, with a lot of mysticism. And of course, for instance, he's using a lot of spermatology in dealing with Renaissance idea of spermatological soul or with Kabbalistic things. So it's fascinating in my opinion, but it moves us in a very kind of fantastic baroque biology that I find very interesting, but I don't know what
Let's
to tell
earlier.
Yeah. What is... you mean the idea of field? What is interesting for you? I think the idea of field is very much disappearing from Russian culture. It remains, of course, in Lubitschev in some people. There is certain kind of resistance to description, I think, in Russian culture. It moves very much, as I understand, Russian cinema or Russian literature, very much from a morphological description of everything into big narratives. So I think we can claim that in the 30s what is happening, history is given to us no more in terms of dynamic form, morphological form, but in terms of big, big ideological narratives. And we can find probably some elements of it in people who were interested in, for instance, thermodynamics and energy, because there is, of course, certain relation between thermodynamics and energy. There is, of course, a big influence of Nietzsche. Nietzsche was very much interested in the idea of field, and he was very much influenced also by the idea of center, of Kraftzentrum, and something like that, which is very similar to it and the influence of Boscovich and so on. So there is certain kind of influence, of course, that we can find. But in general, I think there is this kind of loss of interest in description. This loss of interest, it's already visible, I think, in Shklovsky and his evolution, and when he is writing in the 30s that we are entering into the time of continuous art. So when we are entering into the field of continuous art, the idea of defacement is already disappearing. So fundamentally what he was dreaming about continuity, a certain kind of opening to vision, is becoming continuity in terms of narrative that has nothing to deal with defacement and complexity of form or something that we are dealing with, a simple linearity. So I think in general, in the 30s there is a movement toward linearity. Some people, I don't know, you can probably tell me better what about Harms or Drewski and all these people quite interested in this kind of weird spaces or invisible things which could be similar to entelechia or something like that. They are probably very much still in this kind of problematics. But they are of course becoming an extraordinary minority that is exterminated.
So thank you. This was really fascinating. I happened to just read the proofs for a book that's going to come out soon by Steve Cassidy on touching on a lot of these same issues and talking about the sort of fascination with vitalism and with Bergson around, you know, 1913 or something, the beginning of the century in the U.S. and linking it to, as you do, to a kind of anxiety around evolution. But what he argues is that we have to read this sort of passion for Bergson not as an actual attack, an actual rejection of evolution, but as an acceptance of it, as a kind of given that we, that people at this time, at the beginning of the century, sort of, that there was no use fighting it, what you could do was embrace a kind of vitalism as a sort of aesthetic response, knowing that it wasn't an intellectual response. And I think that that's something that might be worth worth you sort of bringing your Russian examples into dialogue with. Also, interestingly, Cassidy argues that that you should see this acceptance of evolution as part of a kind of larger understanding of people as networked. So bringing up your arguments about technology, a sense that people sort of accepted that they were inside these, you know, networks, connections, which should be understood as spatial rather than temporal. So that he argues that you're really seeing, you accept that you're part of evolution, that evolution is sort of unfightable and is part of this kind of spatial way in which you have to understand both your own body and your own body as existing in conjunction with other bodies and the way that space is organized. Perhaps in the Soviet context, it was more possible for people to really want to reject evolution. Or perhaps your people are really fundamentally similar to the Americans that Cassidy is describing. What do you think?
First of all, I didn't read the book.
Yes, well, it's not out yet. It's actually just
proofs. I would like to be well understood. First of all, I do not think. I am, of course, radicalizing a little bit their position, telling they are against evolution. They are against evolution in causal Darwinian way. But of course, they all admit evolution, because even morphological description, it's a description how something is moving and something is changing. But it changes not in terms of linear causality, but in terms of spatial interaction.
But Darwin doesn't talk about causality, right? Darwinism, it's not causality either.
There is a strong causality in Darwin, because there is something is happening, and after it, there is a fixation of this by selection. So there is a causality, because Darwin is always dealing with genetic linearity. There is something happening to your predecessor. It will be fundamentally recorded in your kind of organism and will be transmitted and it will become a part of your species. So there is always a causal genetic event which is after it's selected or destroyed or whatever it is, but still preserved. But so there is a causality and there is a linearity in Darwin, which is obvious. In my opinion, there is no problem. So, but Darwin, of course, is not describing it in terms of spatial relations.
I don't see causality, I'm sorry. You know, like cause and effect. I mean, there is a inheritance and so on. I mean, traits are inherited, but they're not caused. I mean, like...
Why is they are not caused?
Well, I mean, they just evolve. I mean, causality is something else.
No, they are evolving because something is happening, and after it, there is a preservation of this event somehow inscribed into organism and species, and it's always the inheritance of this event which is the cause of development. So there is a causal linearity behind, I think, Darwin, and of course what they are trying to do, it's a kind of something that they are calling simultaneity. And simultaneity is, of course, a very important term, and now we are coming back to simultaneity, and simultaneity in Jung, and whatever, even we are very critical and skeptical about Jung, but the idea of strange happening of different events in space, synchronicity, I'm sorry. So this is something which is a very kind of different idea of interaction and evolution. So when I'm talking about criticism about evolution, I'm talking about causal Darwinism, and that Grisha doesn't accept. But they thought in these terms, and they are talking about this morphological description of fields which are dealing with space. Of course, Bergson was important, first of all, with the introduction of Elan Vital and things like that, but also because the main topic of Bergson, its main discovery of Bergson, that time is always converted into space. And this is something very important for myself. I think that history should be described in terms of this conversion. So I just, this, what I was presenting to you, it's a part of a book that I just published, which is called Spatial History, which is dealing with exactly with this mechanism of conversion. And I was working for this on landscape as an attempt to integrate history or something like that. So there's always this idea of space, which is becoming the integrative something for history. This is what I'm very much interested in.
Professor Jampolsky, thank you very much.
Thank you.